What's up, Wisconsin? Welcome to Raised in Wisco with Joel Clavish and Danielle Fairman. Danielle's got the week off this week, but that's all right. We got Rob Brennecke in the studio co-hosting with me today, and we've got some awesome guests today. Rob Sherper of Sherper's Outdoor Adventure Store in Hills Corners and Oconomowoc, one of my favorite places to shop and get my outdoor stuff. And Jean Reed stopped in tonight, too, because her daughter is a youth hunter who got her start in hunting and not coming from a hunting family. We're going to talk a little bit about that later in the show. But I got to tell you, right now in the state of Wisconsin, it is great to be an outdoors person. Right now, and I have to say, the duck hunting season ended this last Sunday, and I had so much fun. We hunted from a little island on a southeast Wisconsin lake and shot some of the most beautiful divers I've ever seen, golden eyes out there. That ended. Now there's a break, a two-week break for goose, and a lot of people say, gosh, I wish we didn't have the break, wish we don't have to wait, but I love it because you get a little bit of time to get back out in the turkey woods. I do love my fall turkey hunting, I'm just saying. But you also have the antlerless hunt coming up statewide, so you still got a chance to harvest a doe or, you know, an immature buck for the freezer, which is fun. Rob Sherper is here from Oconomowoc. The story goes like, Rob, are you ready for the story? Can I tell it on the air?
Yeah.
It's fine. All right. So this is about, I don't know, 15, 16 years ago. I'm going to date myself here. I'm at my house on Okachi Lake, and there's a knock at the back door. And there's literally a child coming to my back door, maybe 12-year-old child. He says, hi, Mr. Clayfish, want to come out and go ice fishing with me? And it was Rob Sherper. And I think we've known each other. That makes it for probably near 20 years, 20-plus years.
Yeah, about 20 years.
What did I say when you came to the door?
I think you actually did come out with me that day. We were talking about it. That was when Becky was pregnant with your first, and the first one wasn't here yet, so she allowed you to come out and play that day.
Well, she's a good woman, and I'll tell you, I think there was a learning curve. I always tell people, you don't really lose bachelorhood when you get married. You lose it when you have a child. I think that I still kind of was acting like a bachelor because you had a follow-up story that you came to ask me to go fishing about a week or two after my first child was born.
Yep.
What happened
then? And she still let you go out fishing.
And she still said
yes. And now that I have two children of my own, I was surprised at that.
Well, I'm going to tell you right now, I can tell you there was a learning curve on that one because a few weeks later, she looked me dead in the eyes and said, I don't care about this so-called crappie run. Yeah. You have a new child, and I could use a little help around the house. So that was how Rob Sherper and I got acquainted with each other and met the very first time. And I think we've had 20-plus years of a camaraderie and friendship and business relationship at times. And it's really a joy to get out there and hunt with you, Rob. Your family's fantastic.
Well, thank you.
The stores you guys have are fantastic. In Oconomowoc reminds me, I have to say hello to our Oconomowoc listeners, the Kennedy clan. Robin's son, Aiden, so just a perfect example. Robin's son, Aiden, has never hunted before. He's got his mentored turkey hunt permit. So I've been taking him out. I'm going to continue taking him out, try to get him a turkey. And we've hunted a couple times now and seen turkeys both times. And he asked me, do you ever see them fly out of the trees? And I said, it's not super often, but rare occasion you see it. And that's one of the coolest sights ever. Well, he was with me on the last hunt and we got to see that. And Aiden's just a fantastic kid, and I'm kind of bummed because we've gone a few times already and he has not had a shot at a turkey, which is unusual for me. If I'm taking someone, I got pretty dialed in, but he hasn't had a shot yet, but he's still all jacked about it. He's like, people don't understand how cool this is. So getting out there is that cool. I had a talk tonight with a friend from Concord. I sat at her kitchen table and we talked about hunting and the hunting culture as it exists in southeast Wisconsin. I want to give a shout out her. And of course, my college roommate, Matt Craddock, listening from Colorado, wanted to say hi to Robbie the Sherpa.
We ice fished a long, long time ago in a shack in Ice House Bay.
He said, the last time I saw Rob Sherper, he was a little kid. And now here he is, a full-grown adult with children of his own. And I'm thrilled to say that's the kind of friendships you make in hunting, fishing, and utilization of the outdoors. Rob Brennecke,
how are you?
Guest hosting today.
I am.
You're going to have to kick it up a notch if you want to earn the title of guest host.
All right, I'll turn it up a little bit. No, we'll leave the
I thought you were going to have a couple of tequilas before the show and maybe, you know.
Well, I probably should have. But.
So you have a story that I want to tell a little bit later in the show because it's both heartbreaking yet understandable and a very much a part of hunting. So, and we got a full studio tonight at the Fishbowl downtown Waukesha. Please give us a call if you're listening. The show goes on until 8 o'clock. So if you're listening on the internet, on the interwebs, you can give us a holler, but we're going to get to that story in a minute. First, I want to talk to, Gene Reed, who's with us. Gene comes from a family that is not a hunting family.
That's not entirely true.
Okay. Well, your daughter.
But continue with your version.
Because your daughter's 15 years old now.
Correct.
Yeah, don't let the facts get in the way of a good story, Gene.
Okay? All right.
Gene's daughter was, how old was she the first time we went?
Oh, boy. Maybe 12.
12, maybe 12. Says, Mom, I'd like to try hunting. Now, not really hunting in the immediate family. That's fair to say.
Correct. That's so absolutely true.
I take this young girl out on a mentored hunt for the first time in her life. And I don't know if I don't remember if we got a turkey the first time or not. Did we?
The first year?
Yeah.
I believe we did.
Yeah.
Yes, we did.
So here's a young woman, fastest growing group of new hunters is women, ages 18 to 35. So we have a 15-year-old girl, goes out hunting, absolutely falls in love with it, starts buying camouflage clothing, starts bugging me about when can we go hunting again. What does that teach you, Gene, as a mom with a child, not having, you know, hunting influences in the immediate family, but now you've got a 15-year-old daughter who's completely into it, bugs the heck out of you to hunt. I take her hunting as often as I can, and we've had a great deal of success as two turkeys and a deer in the last 3 years.
That's right. Well, one deer that she was able to keep, and she did actually have one. We won't go into that. Well,
no, that's
stolen.
That's an interesting story. So she did shoot a deer, and we were on the blood trail searching for the deer for a couple hours, eventually find tire treads pulled up to the blood pile, and the deer gone. Someone drove on.
Oh, my God.
Someone drove on a neighboring property,
this
grabbed
was her
the deer.
First deer. And
yes.
It got,
yeah,
that is
right up from underneath her.
Her deer got stolen.
Mm-hmm.
Ugh, that's never fun.
I mean, can you even believe that?
No, that's crazy.
That's crazy to me.
Well, we were tracking it, and she was doing a really, really good job tracking, too. She has these young eyes, and she could see much better than either Joel or myself.
What are you saying about the age of my eyes, Gene?
It's the same as mine. And she was doing a great job tracking, and probably about 5 minutes into the track, we heard a gunshot. And Joel turned around and looked at me and said, I hope that wasn't. And his voice trailed off and turned out that
turns
is
out
what
someone
it was.
Saw the injured deer, popped it, and drove onto a different property and grabbed it. But that's the bad news of the story. The good news is she did end up harvesting a deer and a couple turkeys. And this is how, folks, if you're listening and you haven't taken somebody hunting, it is 10 times more satisfying than going hunting yourself. Rob, you've taken new hunters hunting.
Yep.
What's that like when they harvest their first animal and you're sitting next to them?
It's just awesome. I mean, even this weekend hunting with you guys, when we were sitting there grilling out and having a good time, and like that to me these days is almost more fun than harvesting a big pile of animals or a big pile of birds or whatever you want to call it. I mean, getting somebody out and for their first time harvesting an animal or catching a fish or anything like that, it is probably more gratifying feeling than what you felt the first time you did it because you're passing it on. I mean, it's just so cool to be able to take people out like that that have either don't understand it or had different expectations. And then once they really experience it, it's heart touching, no doubt about it. So
yeah, and you know, this is what I love. I can't tell you how excited I get. You own a store that is quintessentially the basis of the outdoor industry. You want to do it in the outdoors, you can go to Sherper's and do it in the outdoors. Even, you know, if kayaking or mountain climbing is your thing, you can do it at Sherper's. If hunting or waterfowl, deer, big game is your thing, you can go to Sherper's and learn how to do it. And the point I'm trying to make is, nothing against the big box stores, okay? They have their place. There's no doubt about it. But there are still stores in this United States of America, and Wisconsin in particular, that are owned by people who are sharing the waters and woods with the people who are utilizing their stores. Those are the kind of people you want when you go into a place and you want to equip yourself to be warm in the cold, to be cool in the heat, and to be able to have the most success and the most enjoyment while you're out there. Because I tell people, and Jean knows this with her daughter, a cold hunter is not a pleasant hunter who wants to go back. And when you got kids out there and you've got people who are used to being in 72 degree climates and you're taking them out into 20 degrees or 10 degrees, you know, there's no such thing as bad weather, just inappropriate clothing. Yep. I think it says it somewhere in your story.
That was our store slogan in the window for a long time, and it's true.
And you can even ask Gene, when we go out there, I don't even know how the three of us carry all the crap we take out there to hunt for turkeys, because we've got heaters in the blind and food in the blind, and I'm taking my daughter out this weekend. And folks, if you are hunting turkeys, remember you got to wear your blaze orange, because we are in the antlerless season. But Gene, it's pretty comfortable when we hunt, isn't it?
It is. You take good care of us. You always remember to bring a heater, which is essential. If it ever drops below 60 degrees.
Oh, yeah, I sit there sweating, but Alexa's perfectly fine eating her granola bars.
Right, and her beef jerky.
So what's that like? What do you think about that as not really a hunter yourself?
I'm not, no. Although.
Although you have tried it.
I shot a turkey, Joel.
That's right. You did shoot a turkey.
I did, and I made turkey wild soup out of it and turkey pot pie.
Yes, you did. See, so what's that like, having not had real any personal experience in hunting, but having a daughter who drew you into it, and now you're making wild game for holidays and stuff like that?
Right. You know what? There are only two things that she leaps out of bed for willingly at 3 a.m. One is golf, and the other is hunting. She can't get enough of it. She loves it. And it's great to see her take on, develop a passion and just really go for it. She loves it.
That's awesome. And that's how fast the show goes. We're already done with one quarter of it. When we come back, Rob Sherper from Sherper's Outdoor Adventure Store, Rob Brennecke, my buddy, and Gene Reed. We'll be right back on Raised in Wisco with Joel and Danielle. Thanks a lot, Kelvin. Kelvin's in there. He's messing with me. He's got a big smile on his face right now. He's playing Hunter's Creed by yours truly. I think we're up to like 42 downloads now over 10 years.
That's a hit.
It's a big hit, isn't it? Hey, welcome back to Raised in Wisco with Joel Clayfish and Danielle Fairman. Danielle's on a break, and Rob Brennecke is guest hosting today. We got Rob Sherper from Sherper's Outdoor Adventure Store and Jean Reed, mother of a brand new mentored hunter who's been at it now for a little while and had some fantastic harvests. Sherper, I want to talk to you. How did it happen in your life? You know, mom and dad own an outdoor adventure store. If you had a dream in your life, Brennecke, if you ever had a dream in your life, would there be a better dream than to say your mom and dad own an outdoor adventure store? The name outdoor adventure store.
Oh, Sherper's living it. For sure.
So what came first, the outdoor adventure store or Rob Sherper, the outdoor adventurer?
Probably Rob Sherper, the outdoor adventurer. Well, I shouldn't say that. The store definitely came first.
Well, the store physically, literally came first.
Yep.
Did you become an outdoor adventure person because of the store, or did you love it and it just so happened to be the awesomest thing in the world that your parents owned it?
I just started to love it. And really, I would say the person that got me into the outdoors the most was my mom and or my mom's dad, so my grandpa. My dad, actually, believe it or not, the first time he ever went hunting was when I was 12 years old, got my hunter safety and could go hunting. And that was the first time we ever went hunting. And he told me now he realizes what people use all this stuff for.
Wow.
So,
well, I'm glad you broke that over the air for everybody to know he was selling it all. No,
he's always been a skier and a hiker and a camper and things like that. But he was never the hunter fisherman type as much as my mom's side of the family. So and that's kind of where I grew to love it. So
that brings me to something I want to talk to you about that can be kind of a sensitive subject for people sometimes. There are two very, very diametrically different branches of outdoor adventure in Wisconsin.
Yeah.
You've got the, and I don't mean to stereotype. I want to be clear. I don't mean to stereotype because part of this conversation is going to be about the crossover. But you've got the hunter fisherman type, which crosses over with the camping type. And then you have the backpacker, jet boil, rock climbing, kayak, skiing type, which crosses over with the camping.
Yep.
And you guys have figured out a way, the only store I know of that's figured out a way to cater to both crowds without the animosity that sometimes exists between those crowds.
Yep. And I think one of the reasons that maybe has happened is because us as a family has kind of done both. We are both. I'm a kayaker. I'm a camper. I'm not necessarily a rock climber. I need to lose a few lbs before that happens. But I'm a hunter. I'm a fisherman. But yeah, I mean, it's not easy to put it that way because you have to be very diverse in what you carry in selection in the store, and it's tricky many days to be able to do that. But I'm glad to say that we do that, and we still do some military surplus, which was actually our roots.
I love it.
So
I love the military stuff. It's so
and even
cool.
Government surplus. Sometimes we have random things that you just don't know where we got them from, but we got a bunch of them, and they're cheap. So.
But the second part of that conversation is that there are actual philosophical differences by many of the people who are in the hunting, fishing, Second Amendment camp versus the rock climbing, kayak, nature preservation camp. And some folks on both of those sides can get nasty toward the folks on the other side of that. And what I want to talk about for a minute, because I think this is incredibly important, is that we are literally seeing those sides bend around and meet each other now with organic eating, with harvesting an animal that lives a free life instead of a raised life to be slaughtered, to be put in a package at the grocery store. And let me be clear, there's nothing wrong with that in my belief. But are you seeing it in the industry that those opposing philosophies are starting to see more common ground? And isn't it our duty to show them the common ground and help facilitate that?
No doubt. I think there's definitely some more common ground between, call it the two different groups, or in some ways I almost look at it as there has been common ground in between the two groups, and people are finally realizing that they can be outspoken, that they are a part of one group or another, or do both. And we're all outdoorsmen that love to spend time outdoors, whether or not that's camping on the banks of the Mississippi River or hunting ducks on the same river or going fishing on the same river, because we all love to get out there. And the end goal is the same, enjoying time outdoors, simply put.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. I think part of the realization also is that the hunting fishing faction of society, which ebbs and flows, it goes up and down, especially in Wisconsin. And we're actually seeing, we saw kind of an odd thing happen this year. We saw fewer license sales, but more deer harvests during the gun deer season.
Yep.
So I attribute that to better hunting. I think people are able to learn more, utilize the technology more.
No doubt.
I think people are using game cameras more. But I think it's, and I don't know if the answer is to say quality versus quantity, but when you talk about somebody who is a hunter, fisherman, provider. They want to put that game on the table versus somebody who believes they're protecting the environment and they kayak and rock climb. And in many cases, they are stewards of the environment, very much so. There's also has to be that realization that hunters and fishermen are stewards of the environment and conservationists as well. In fact, the largest portion of money that goes to conservation in the state of Wisconsin, and I'm pretty sure in the United States, is from hunters and fishermen.
No doubt.
Because if you love to hunt, if you love to fish, there's nothing to hunt and fish unless that resource is protected and cultivated.
Yep.
So do you see those conversations in your industry?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we see them all the time. I mean, I've even had, you want to talk about it, even touch your subject, I've talked to some of the people about wolves in the store, and I see both sides of that. So.
Well, we got to go to break already. When we come back, I want to talk about wolves real quick, and then we got to fit in Rob Brennecke's story of his massive buck that he may or may not have missed this weekend. This is Raised in Wisco. We'll be right back. Raised in Wisco, I'm your host Joel Clayfish, along with Danielle Fairman. She's on break. We got Robbie Brennecke in the co-host seat tonight, and some really awesome guests: Rob Sherper from Sherper's Outdoor Adventure Store, Jean Reed, mother of a mentored hunter and a bit of a hunter and provider herself. She made wild turkey soup, she said, with the turkey she killed. How did that turn out, Jean? Was the wild turkey soup and the turkey pot pie any good?
It was awesome, actually, and that was the turkey I shot, the turkey that my daughter shot the year prior. We shot it the day before. Actually, I think we shot it Christmas Eve or the day before, and I made it for Christmas Eve. And my family all said it was the best turkey they've ever had.
Wow.
Including any Thanksgiving meal they had ever had.
Oh, my goodness. So, well, they were lying.
But, yeah, I was going to say, I need the recipe for that one.
No, there are ways to make wild turkey that it turns out absolutely fantastic. I make a wild turkey Christmas casserole, which is phenomenal, if I do say so myself, but food's my favorite dish. So, do you have any other remnants of the wild turkeys around your house, Jean?
Well, we have the mount on my daughter's displayed
you have
proudly.
A turkey mount on
proudly
the wall
displayed.
In your home. Does that fit with your decor, Jean?
This is in my daughter's bedroom, so it fits just fine.
Oh, perfect. You know, I'm a big fan of utilizing every part of the animal when you kill it, and I have probably 40 or so mounts, and my wife allows one in the greater part of the house. They all have to get jam-packed into my small little man cave. But she allows one in the major part of the room above the fireplace. And she has rules for it. It has to look exotic. I'm not sure exactly what that means, but it has to look exotic. That means no whitetails. So we have a rotating mount that goes above our fireplace. But I do not have a wolf mount yet, that I can tell you. Sherper, you were talking about the difference in philosophies and beliefs around the timber wolf.
Yeah.
You hear about that a lot in your stores?
I do. I mean, and like we were talking about, I think we have people that come into our stores from very much two different walks of life, especially when it pertains to wolves. And I've talked to some of the very anti-wolf people, meaning that they don't want them around. And I've talked to the people that are pro-wolf to the point where that they don't want any harvest. They want the wolf to be protected. And I, kind of out of necessity, but also because I truly believe it, I kind of stand in the middle. I do think that we should have seasons for wolves, but I do think that there is a place for the wolf here in the state, and there's nothing wrong with having an apex predator in the state either. Humans and wolves can coexist, and that's my opinion on it. And I've even talked to a few of the wolf activists, will you, and I've had good conversations with them versus basically throwing words at each other and trying to light a fire under each other. And I won't ever do that with anyone because I love to hear the sides of both. So,
and that's something that's In my belief, that's a human quality that we all overlook very often, is that with any other human being, regardless what their beliefs are, we all have more in common than we have more in than we have in opposition. Yeah. And what I've found is that finding common ground with people, and a common ground when it comes to wildlife, is that we all believe there should be healthy populations. Healthy populations means not too few and not too many. A lot of folks don't realize if it weren't for hunters, the wild turkey would not exist in the numbers it does in the state of Wisconsin. It was hunters who contributed to the funding that reintroduced and proliferated the wild turkey in the state of Wisconsin, much with the wolf populations similar as well.
Yep.
And deer populations, you know.
And elk now.
And elk. We've got three elk populations in Wisconsin now. We're harvesting two a year. And I think down the road we're going to be harvesting more because they're doing very well. We have a climate here in Wisconsin that is very conducive to elk. We are seeing the Mississippi Flyway with ducks and geese burgeoning.
Mm-hmm. I know it was kind of before my time, but the Canada goose population, I heard, what was that, in the 70s and 80s, was just terrible.
It was terrible.
Yeah.
I remember driving down the road. And my parents say, there's a goose. We'd pull the car over and try to take a look at it.
Yeah.
Now I'm eating goose just about every day.
Yep, and shoot them off the golf courses.
Yeah, well, the golf courses don't love the geese. But the fact of the matter is, we've gotten to a point where we can all agree that healthy populations mean not too many, a sustainable amount, but not too few. And, you know, one example of that, back in the legislature, I wrote a bill for urban hunting of deer. We are seeing incredibly large populations in very urban areas that are running into cars, hurting people, in some cases killing them. So we but beyond that, when a population gets too big in a small area, it starts to spread disease and starve. And the last thing any animal lover or even anti-hunter wants is starving members of an animal group. So exactly. I think it's important that we all realize conservation is on the forefront of the vast majority of people who are ethical on both sides.
Yep, no doubt. I mean, I've even kind of seen this firsthand. This last year, I was going up to Saskatchewan, duck and goose hunting up there. And at first, we weren't sure we were going to be able to bring any birds home because of the avian flu. Well, the snow geese are a prime example of an overpopulating bird right now. They're so overpopulated to the point where the harvest limits are way up there in the spring. As a matter of fact, you can harvest as many as you want of them, but that is one of the migratory birds, at least, that is contributing to the avian flu spread because of how packed they are and just how overpopulated they are. So as hunters, we need to do something about it and take more of the snow geese. So, and it's becoming a very popular thing to do, not necessarily here in Wisconsin, but in the Central Flyway more so. But that's an example of it. And I wouldn't doubt if their population continues to expand the way it has that, shoot, 10, 20 years in Wisconsin, we might be a part of their flyway. So
I would not doubt it whatsoever. And I think another part that sometimes people overlook is that you have a food protein source, and something that Wisconsin has done and other states have done is allow for very, very easy transmitting of your harvested wild game to food banks. Mm-hmm. And those who provide food to the needy. And we're talking about protein sources that are incredibly healthy to eat, organic protein sources. And we literally have the ability in many states to substantially help solve the hunger problems by the harvest of wild game. And part of the regulatory nature of things in all states is that it kind of takes a while for the laws to catch up with what's needed. But I actually think we're seeing that now. I think we're seeing it start to catch up. You know, the snow geese is a real great example of something that's got to be allowed in high numbers because their overpopulation has them in such tight quarters that they're spreading the disease. You've got birds that are starving and dying, and now you're moving those wild game sources, moving the avian, high path avian, into turkey farms, into
pheasant farms,
pheasant farms right here in the state of Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. One of the greatest people I know owns a pheasant farm that supplies a great deal of the state's pheasant game preserves, had an avian influenza outbreak. And that's coming from wild birds.
Yep.
So keeping populations in check is absolutely integral to healthy conservation.
Yep.
And it's the hunters, the fishermen, the those who utilize the outdoors. You know, look, you're never going to see my chubby rear end in a kayak. I promise you that.
Or I'd like to.
We'll get you in one sometime.
Yeah, that'd be pretty funny.
I don't think they make a kayak wide enough.
Oh, yeah.
But you're never going to see me hanging off a rock ledge either. But those folks are contributing as well, because when they're utilizing the parks in the state of Wisconsin and the waterways, they're also contributing. So it is a concerted effort by all philosophies to make sure we're maintaining a healthy ecological system in Wisconsin for the wild game. When you buy for Sherper's Outdoor Adventure Store, how in the ever-loving hell do you decide what to buy when you're trying to satisfy all those people?
You have to rub your crystal ball and hope that the wizard comes out and tells you the right thing. But it's getting tougher and tougher, especially with the age of what's happened recently with the supply of goods with COVID going on and where we're getting things, because a lot of our stuff is from overseas, unfortunately, still. But that's going to be the nature of goods in the climate of retail, I think. So, but it's getting tougher. We're having to place orders 9 to 12 months out on things right now, and we're just going off of historical data and gut feelings, what we think is going to be the next big thing, what's going to be the next hot brand. So it's not easy, but somehow we managed to get it mostly right, I would say. So,
what blows my mind is how eclectic your store is. I mean, it's crazy. You can go in there and buy a water purification straw and an automatic front opening knife.
Yep.
I mean, that is as far apart from each other as you can imagine.
Yeah.
What are the items through the years that have surprised you or haven't surprised you, but they've been the go-to for people?
Well, there's an oddball one, inert grenades. We still sell military surplus grenades with no charge in them, so that's a very common item. We sell hundreds
of them here for 3 days. I never would have said inert grenades.
So you can buy a pool floaty, a grenade, your hunting and fishing license, a rod and reel to go hunting,
and a
backpack.
Sounds like a
party. But that's one of the things that keeps us unique, because you can buy all those things at Sherper.
Inert grenade.
Yeah, and then to top it all off, if you want a human blood box from, I forget what war that was from, but we still have those in our warehouse, too. So.
Some people used to use those before Yetis were invented. What is a human blood box?
It's a cooler, basically. And the reason we sold them is prior to the super coolers, the Yetis out there, basically, people would take these things and use them for, say, harvesting game out west, and they had to drive home with their elk or moose or whatever they might have gotten. There were some of the best coolers that you could buy, because that's what they were designed to keep human blood cold in war, so for blood transfusions. So we still have a few of them in our warehouse if you want one for your man room.
Very interesting.
Too bad radio does not show faces, because I am perplexed right now. Hey, I've got a 5-day drive. I shot my elk. Don't worry, I have a human blood box.
Give me three, please.
Hey, do you have any human blood boxes left? I need to take my elk from Wisconsin to Nevada. What about some of the hot items this year? Christmas is right around the corner.
I would say some of the cool items this year, and there's a few different companies out there making them, but we're selling a lot of these stainless steel fireplaces, so the ones that are kind of portable that you can take to, it's kind of a leave no trace thing too. So you basically, it kind of looks like a wash basin, like a wash tub, but it's made out of stainless steel to be able to create a fire in, and it's vented to the point where everything combusts perfectly, so there's no smoke. We have a wooden deck at home, and you can actually set this thing on your wooden deck. It's so insulated that you can have a fire right there. So it's basically a portable fire. So that's been super popular in the last few years. Kayaks have absolutely exploded, especially during the height of COVID, because people wanted to get away from each other but still enjoy the outdoors. So kayaks was a huge thing for us, and still is even in the winter here. So we finally have caught up and actually have inventory of that kind of stuff again, where we hadn't for a long time. So
kayaks are really really taking off in the hunting space. Yep. I never imagined they would.
And fishing. Fishing big time, too. And there's, I mean, there's kayak fishing tournaments now that are kayak specific only, and you can rig a kayak these days and have live scope and spot lock on it.
Yeah. So, hey, let's talk to Dave. Dave called in. I don't know if he has a question or if he's going to call us on the carpet for something. Dave, welcome to Raised in Wisco, Dave. What can we do for you?
Hi, guys. I'm just want to make a comment. You guys got a great show, first of all.
Thank you.
I want to make
a comment
about the, you guys are talking about Brittany Griner getting released. And so I think it's a great thing she got.
I think Dave called the wrong show there.
Dave. Sorry, Dave.
Dave, I think you called the wrong show.
Yep.
Brittany Griner's release will be the topic of Raised in Wisco next week.
Yeah.
Whoa.
That came out. Calvin, what's going on in that studio? I'm telling you.
That came out.
I should have asked him if he knew what show he was calling to, but...
Oh, man, we've got one segment of the show left. Please call in if you're interested. Rob Sherper's on the show. Rob Brennecke is guest hosting. Gene Reed is here, and Michael Jackson's going to take us to the break. You're listening to Raised in Wisco. I'm your host, Joel Clayfish. Welcome back, everybody, to Raised in Wisco with Joel Clayfish and Danielle Fairman wrapping up the show. We got a quarter hour left or a little bit less. We got Rob Sherper from Sherper's Outdoor Adventure Store. Rob Brennecke is guest hosting today. And Gene Reed's in the studio, new hunter and a daughter who we've brought into hunting. I want to say with Aiden Kennedy and Alexa Reed, I've hunted recently with both of them. And if you are a hunter and you've yet to take a new hunter, that will be the best experience you have in the woods. When somebody harvests, you ever notice this if you take a new turkey hunter, a new duck hunter, when they actually get their first harvest, when they get their first kill, they don't jump up and down, they don't start screaming, they look right at you.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause they want you to confirm that they actually did it. You did it. You mm-hmm. did it.
So great.
And it is a feeling unlike any other, and that is the only way we're going to make providers out of these young kids whose heads are stuck in their telephones. Get them out there to do something in 3D. You know, we spent last weekend, actually, coincidentally, Rob Sherper, Rob Brennecke, and I hunted with Steve Gunther and John, his buddy, and we were on an island hunting divers, and we had the time of our lives. And I don't think one of us looked at our phones once.
No.
It's so great. I mean, we cooked, and we cooked duck sausage and duck brats.
The duck sausage was the best I've ever had.
That duck sausage was unbelievable.
Yeah,
I know.
Unbelievable.
I'm bribing Sherpa to give me some of that because that stuff was outstanding.
Oh, I've got plenty of that. We'll be making more too.
Well, I'm gonna start giving you some of my goose and ducks so that you can make it for me. Let's go to the phones real quick. Bill called in from Milwaukee. Bill, appreciate you listening to the show. Welcome to the show, Bill. What do you got for us?
Yeah, this question was for Robbie. I was listening to you guys talk about, harvesting deer. And I brought up to my buddy the other day that I wanted to do a deer drive with crossbows, wondering what his idea was on that.
Hi, Jake. you can do that if you want to, but I wouldn't necessarily encourage it. You always want to make sure that you take a nice, good, ethical shot at a deer. And running deer with a crossbow, really running deer in general, is not a great idea. So personally, I don't feel that it would be a wise idea.
You got a smirk on your face over there, Shirk. I think one of your buddies was trying to give you the
business. This is one of my buddies. He was involved in helping make this duck sausage, I'm sure, a few whiskeys
you
in
last year. You guys don't have any cocktails while you do that, do
no,
you?
No,
never. I didn't think so. In fact, I noticed it a brandy finish to the breakfast sausage, yeah. I think. It might have just been from your breath in the sausage grinder. But you know the old saying, I don't want to see how the sausage is made. So, the other, along those lines, though, I'm just going to say I don't participate in deer drives. I do not have an ethical problem with them. I do not have a problem with them. I do not participate in them. I don't feel comfortable.
I don't either. Scare me.
Yep.
But I think that's not to say that deer drives cannot be handled in, you know, wide open spaces with very safely.
Yep.
But I think every deer drive should have the talk ahead of it about the ethical shot.
The ethics and the safety.
You know, and your target and what's beyond.
Exactly.
Because that, when it comes to a deer drive, you don't want to be flinging bullets if there's a subdivision a mile away because the bullet travels a mile if it's angled at the right.
And having the right plan to execute it. I mean, I have because I shouldn't say that I have nothing wrong with deer drives. I used to do it when I was younger all the time.
Sure, I've done them before.
Yeah. And I think it's very much dependent on the land that you're hunting at the time, too, versus I listened to the podcast last week with you guys and Paul talking about giving the deer their sanctuaries, their bedding areas, staying out of there. And that's typically what guys are driving. And there's nothing wrong with that because, you're going to have great success pushing deer out of a bedding area. But if you're trying to hold, especially your older, mature, larger deer on a property, that's the wrong thing to do is go in there, especially during gun season, to disturb him. Because if he sneaks out of that property in the right spot and goes to your neighbors, well, then you're going to be really sad.
Then you'll never have a shot at him.
Exactly.
Brennecke had a shot at a deer this last week.
Oh, that's what I've heard.
With a smoke pole. What happened?
Well, let me tell you. I missed. I played out.
Is that the whole story?
I did. I missed. I honestly, I think buck fever bit me.
I think that is both a bad thing because you missed, but a good thing because I tell people when you stop getting excited about it, stop doing it. And I can
100%.
Tell you when those geese are circling and you're trying to talk them in for that final approach or when that deer pokes when you see the antlers first or, you know, if you're traveling and hunting an exotic species, the first time you see a new animal you're pursuing that you've never seen before, there is very, very little that trumps that type of excitement.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you seeing new hunters in the store? What do you see as far as those? Are you seeing more women?
I would say definitely seeing more women. I would say there's more youth getting involved, and it even seems to me people my age. So I'm a millennial, basically. So they put it out there that I see people my age that maybe
look at even millennials are embarrassed to admit it. I love it. It's so funny.
I was gonna say something, but
he's an anomaly. He's a millennial with a job who actually goes out hunting.
Yeah, so
it's got a great store.
But no offense to the rest of the millennials. Come on,
the millennials my age now, that's maybe they hadn't grown up that way of life or they've never done it before and now they've are in a friend group with a bunch of buddies that are like, oh, come on hunting with us, and they're like, no, that's not my cup of tea, and they go out and absolutely love it. So like,
you're
that's
right.
Is what's cool to see, because face it, a lot of the gear that we sell these days too lasts for a long time, so that customer doesn't need to come back and buy the same thing. So I see a lot of new people into the sport, whether it's in a kayak or hunting or fishing or whatever it is. There are a lot of newbies in the sport, and that's kind of who we cater to. So, and it's cool to see the diversity out there. I mean, we talked about it this weekend when we were done hunting. We know a buddy that comes into our shop and buys a turkey permit every other day, and he's 80 some years old, and he gets out there after it every
turkey
single
John.
Day. Turkey John, and he is a turkey slayer and a turkey wizard. So
and I taught him everything he knows.
Yep.
In fact, we did go hunt. We have gone hunting together quite a bit, Turkey John and I, and he's an interesting character. But boy, does he love turkey hunting.
Oh, yes.
I'll tell you that.
That's great to see the different ages. So
as we wrap up the show, Rob, why don't you give us your advice to those out there, you know, sitting in their parents' basement connected to the virtual reality, playing the video games, sitting on their phones all day, or the house husband or housewife who's never tried it and they're getting bored. What's your advice to them to get out there and try hunting and fishing?
Hook up with a friend, hook up with one of us, hook up with somebody that can kind of show you the ropes and just get out there. An experience in the outdoors is never a bad experience. It's always better than a day at work.
Rob Sherper, you are the real deal. Thank you very much for coming in. What a great show we've had tonight. For Rob Brennecke, Gene Reed, and Rob Sherper, I'm Joel Clayfish. We'll see you next week on Raised in Wisco.